at this time of year we would normally do our service of lessons and carols, and the word normally no longer seems to apply in our world. It's also a rather unusual final Sunday before Christmas, because there's still a whole week to go. Some of you might, like me, say thank goodness for that, because there's still quite a lot to be done. So it feels to me that we're still really in Advent and not at Christmas. We are also a little bit limited in terms of how much time we can enjoy together and how much singing we can do because of the restrictions. So we've chosen this year to focus very much on the person who is the focus of the fourth week of Advent, Mary, and we travel with her up to and including the birth of Jesus this morning. Our call to worship comes from Hebrews 10. When Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. See, God, I have come to do your will, O God." Our opening carol this morning is Joy to the World, and we're just singing the first two verses. Surprises. We gather in anticipation. shaken by the news that you come to us with such life, awaking all that longs to unite with you. For no matter how sleepy or settled or suspicious we may be, you surprise us again and again with your outrageous love and generosity. So we praise you. In the name of Christ, amen. As we pray, we are conscious of the presence of all those in the church family who gather to worship, wherever they are and however they are worshipping. We remember them before God, especially any whose particular needs are known to us. We pray for all who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, for those receiving medical treatment in hospital or in care homes, and for all those who are bereaved. We give thanks for those who companion and support them, and we join with them to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Listen for God's word to us today as we hear the first of our readings from the Gospel. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, How can this be, seeing I am a virgin? The angel said to her, The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. Then Mary said, Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word. Then the angel departed from her. to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leapt for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has looked with favour on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary remained with her about 3 months and then returned to her home. As we have moved through the Advent readings in Luke's Gospel this year, we have seen Christ's coming draw closer. The readings set for the first Sunday in Advent gave us Jesus' words in Jerusalem, which began by speaking of future hope and times to come, but ended with a call for us to be ready, emphasizing the importance of what we do right now in the present. And so we understand that Christ comes in the time in which we live. The reading set for the second Sunday in Advent gives us John appearing not among the places of power, but in the middle of nowhere, a voice in the wilderness. And so we understand that Christ comes to us in the very places where we are. The reading for the third Sunday in Advent gives us the preaching of John the Baptist, with his entirely pragmatic and direct responses to the question asked of him, "What then should we do?" And so we begin to understand that Christ comes in the lives that we are living in the world. And now, on the fourth Sunday of Advent, the Gospel reading set for today is the meeting between Mary and Elizabeth. What does this tell us about Christ's coming? Surely that Christ comes to us in our very bodies and in our most intimate domestic relationships. There is something so human, so bodily, so relational in the picture of these two women greeting, embracing, sharing together. There is something so vigorous, so demanding, so promising in their figures, which are large with new life. There is something so vital, so encouraging, so rich in the way they reflect and testify and affirm the work of God in each other. Truly, all this enables Elizabeth to recognize and Mary to magnify the Lord. Here is divinity writ large and clear, for all to see, so that all may rejoice. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's pray. God, our companion, you gave Mary a wise and loving soul friend to support her as she responded to your call. A spiritual midwife to help her to birth your word. We thank you for those who support our calling, especially when it is secret and tentative, not yet fully formed. Help us to be to others as Elizabeth was to Mary, one who recognizes you at work in their lives and helps them to bring your new work to birth. We thank you too for the faithfulness of Mary, for her courage, her boldness, her initiative, for her willingness to journey, to change, and to suffer, for her wholehearted offering of herself to you and to your work of liberation. May we too be bold in believing, generous in self-offering, and wholehearted in our participation in your work of justice and freedom. We pray that we may journey through these last days of Advent in Mary's company, so that Christ may be born in us. For blessed are they who believe that the promise made to them by the Lord will be fulfilled. In the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to sing our second carol this morning. And it's going to be O Little Town of Bethlehem, but we're missing out verse 3, so verses 1, 2 and 4.
Oh,
Let us pray. I'm sorry, we got another reading. So from Luke chapter 2. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration, and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for him in the inn. Dear God, as we remember the greeting of two women and their unborn children, so we pray for those whose pregnancies were expected and longed for, and for those whose pregnancies were shocking and unwelcome. For those who feel their children will bring joy and fulfillment. And for those who feel unable to bring a child into the world. As we celebrate the gift of a child born to die, so we pray for those whose children have died in the womb. And for those whose children were never conceived. For those whose children were stillborn. And for those whose children's lives were cut short. We pray that all these may yet be open to your love and to new life. As we anticipate the life of a child born to save, so we pray for all that is yet unborn in us, for the potential not yet realized, and the gifts not yet explored, for the love not yet risked, and the visions not yet dreamed, for the hope not yet dared, and the forgiveness not yet received, for the joy not yet delighted in, and the trust in God not yet found. we pray that we all may yet be open to your love and to new life. In the name of the Christ child, we pray. Amen. It feels so wonderfully appropriate that on a day when we think of Christ's coming into human bodies, into intimate relationships, that we should gather to receive Christ in our bodies. And we will be gathering at the Lord's table after our next hymn, and all are welcome to receive. We're doing things a little differently in these days, so the elements which you will be receiving will remain covered until I bring them to you in your seats. And when I come to you, I will wear a mask, stop me if I'm not, and I will be sanitizing my hands before coming. If you would cup your hands if you would like to receive bread, then I can drop bread into your hands, and we retain the elements and then share them together. When it comes to the glasses, if you take your own, and they're fairly well spread out, so it should be possible to take one without touching others. And again, we retain and share together. As we prepare ourselves to gather and receive Christ in our bodies, bring you a carol which may be unfamiliar to you. If you were here a little bit before the service, you may have heard it being played. Neil's going to play it through once, and then we will do our best. But I find it humble and dignified and very significant for this time of year. So if you don't know it, I hope you will enjoy something new. Thou who wast rich beyond all splendor, all for love's sake became as poor. Thank you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O Lord our God, creator and ruler of the universe. As you promised long ago, you have revealed the majesty of your name in a little child born in Bethlehem. He is our joy and our peace. He is our shepherd, feeding us with mercy and leading us in safety. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all the faithful of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of majesty. And blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Born of Mary, Jesus Christ is our salvation and strength, the fulfillment of your word and the hope of generations. Christ lifts up the lowly and fills the hungry with good things. Remembering your gracious acts in Jesus Christ, we take from your creation this bread and this wine, and joyfully celebrate his dying and rising as we await the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be to us the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with Christ and with your Church in all the world. In Jesus Christ, help us to live according to your will. Sanctify and shape us into the image of Christ's body, so that our lives may be a holy offering of love and praise. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Gathered among friends, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. Saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after supper, he took the cup and said, this is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink from it, all of you. And be thankful. The gifts of God. For for the people. Christ's body broken, give you life. Amen. Thank you. blood poured out, give you hope. Amen. In our closing carol, we sing our thanksgiving to God for his indescribable gift. Hark, the herald angels sing. Rest on you and on all those whom you love, this day and forevermore.